Hello friends, we are continuing with our ongoing topic, that is ischemic heart disease, and today we'll be discussing about part 2. In the previous part, we have learnt about the pathophysiology of angina pectoris. We have seen various types of angina. We have classified the drugs which are useful at various levels, and we have seen the salient aspects of organic nitrates. Now in this session, we will be considering the rest of the part, that is other groups of drugs useful for angina and other forms of IHDs. We will outline the medical management of angina and other forms of IHDs. After that, we will have brief discussion about some peripheral vascular disorders. We have seen, friends, that in case of angina, these are the main groups of drugs which are useful: organic nitrates, calcium channel blockers, potassium channel openers, beta blockers. They are the chief drugs. Along with them, cytoprotectives and antiplatelets play adjuvant role. So trimetazidine, renolazine, ivapridine and antiplatelet agents, they are used as adjuvant therapy. We have already discussed about organic nitrates. So we will be continuing with our rest of the drugs which are useful for the treatment of angina. First, we will discuss about beta blockers. Beta blockers, especially beta 1 selective atenolol, metoprolol, bisoprolol, they are useful for the treatment of angina, because non-selective blockers will have more side effects. They are useful at all stages of IHD except vasospastic angina. The reason behind it is, even though they are beta 1 selective, but at higher dose they lose their selectivity and they may cause bronchial asthma or bronchospasm. So for any kind of vasospastic disease, they are contraindicated. If we look to the pharmacological basis of beta blocker, any physical or emotional stress that increases sympathetic activity, we have seen that. With the increase in sympathetic activity, there will be increase in heart rate, blood pressure, myocardial contractility and oxidative metabolism. In nutshell, these all activities can precipitate angina. So the root cause of angina can be considered as increased sympathomimetic activity. Beta blockers, by blocking adrenergic activity, can prevent the whole cascade. So they can prevent angina and control blood pressure in hypertensive patients. If we look to the pharmacological actions of beta blockers, they can increase exercise tolerance without increasing angina index. They prevent subjective as well as ECG manifestations of cardiac ischemia. They reduce arrhythmic activity followed by any exercise or emotion. And if they are used with nitroglycerine, it is claimed that the dose of nitroglycerine can be reduced, or we can say beta blocker can reduce nitroglycerine requirements. On long run, they reduce heart rate and increase diastolic relaxation time, which in turn helps to improve coronary perfusion. So they are used prophylactically with nitrates, as they decrease in the incidence of myocardial ischemia. On long term, especially after MI or LA dysfunction, it is claimed that they reduce the rate of reinfarction and improve survival. But they are not free from side effects. So adverse reactions, as relevant to anti-anginal therapy, they have to be very cautiously used in case of CHF patients, because they can either precipitate or aggravate the features of congestive heart failure in patients who are receiving digitalis. So both digoxin and beta blocker should not be combined. If at all they are combined, they should be very cautiously used. There can be development of severe hypotension and syncope on using concurrent nitroglycerine with beta blockers, especially when the patient is taking both the drugs simultaneously and doing any vigorous exercise. So following concurrent administration of nitroglycerine and beta blockers, if the patient does any vigorous exercise or any stressful activity, patient may develop severe syncope. Obviously, bronchospasm is the known side effect. by beta blockers, and it should not be considered for asthmatic individuals, even for diabetics, because they cause glucose intolerance. Also, they cause weight gain and erectile dysfunctions. These are routine adverse effects. Apart from this, presence of marked bradycardia, AV block, Sick sinus syndrome, or severe heart failure can be considered as absolute contraindications for the use of beta blockers. And friends, we have to be very watchful, we have to be very cautious, because long-term treatment with beta blocker, the body develops physical dependence. So if these drugs are abruptly withdrawn, there may be severe incidence of tachycardia, vasoconstriction, aggravation of angina, or even precipitation of MI. So they should not be abruptly withdrawn. Any of the anti-anginal drugs, be it nitroglycerin or nitrates or beta blockers or calcium channel blockers, should never be withdrawn abruptly. Otherwise, there will be precipitation of angina or even MI, because the body develops physical dependence. The other group, important group after calcium channel blocker is, beta blocker is calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers used in angina are verapamil, diltiazem from the non-DHP group. As we know that verapamil and diltiazem, they are more specific for the channels present at SA node and AV node. And DHP derivatives, nifedipine and amlodipine, they are more rather vasoselective agents. They cause vasodilatation, so they are more selective. They are activity is more preferred for calcium channels present in vascular endothelium. So for angina, non-DHP derivatives are more preferred. If we look to the pharmacological basis, we know that there are L and T types of channels in heart. L channel makes calcium available in the cytoplasm, and it is responsible for initiation of contraction. And T channel play a role in the initial depolarization of SA node and AV nodal tissue. Calcium channel blockers bind to alpha 1 subunit of L channel and inhibit the entry of calcium in the myocardium and other vascular smooth muscles. This is the site of calcium channel blockers action. So they slow down the process of contraction and cause vasodilatation. If we look to the pharmacological actions, especially anti-anginal actions, calcium channel blockers can improve coronary blood flow. They are more potent coronary dilators. Both intermyocardial and epicardial arteries are dilated. So even in case of spasm, they can also prevent spasm. So they are more suitable for vasospastic Prinz Metals angina, where beta blocker was contraindicated. Calcium channel blocker, especially amlodipine, should be thought for Prinz Metals angina. They decrease oxygen demand of heart due to reduction in vascular resistance because of vasodilatation and blood pressure. So they decrease the afterload. Verapamil in addition decreases heart rate also. So in nutshell, oxygen demand is reduced by them. In case of peripheral blood vessels, they are relaxed. Both systemic and pulmonary arterial circulation is relaxed. They lower blood pressure in both the circulation and reduce afterload as well. So in nutshell, they've got very much helpful effect to the heart. If we look to the antiarrhythmic action, they have non-DHPs, especially they have negative inotropic action. They are more non-DHPs have more pronounced effect on SA node and AV nodes. So they have more antiarrhythmic activity. So they decrease the activity of SA node and pacemaker and increase the refractory period of AV node. But they should never be combined with beta blockers. Other actions apart from antiarrhythmic or anti-anginal actions, they have bronchial smooth muscle relaxing property. Ureteric and uterine smooth muscles are also relaxed. This capability can be useful for the use of nifedipine in case of pregnancy-induced hypertension, and it can be used as tocolytic. They can be used for as anti-angina for patients having COPD or asthma, where beta blockers are contraindicated. Nifedipine, nicardipine can be used as topolytics. But they are not free from adverse reactions. Headache, tachycardia, dizziness, fatigue, orthostatic hypotension, leg cramps, skin rashes, and gingival hyperplasia. These are the side effects produced by calcium channel blockers. Occasionally, they can also precipitate congestive heart failure. Mind well, angina may worsen with nifedipine. So, nifedipine is not a suitable drug for angina. Justification for this sentence is, nifedipine can cause rapid fall in blood pressure. This rapid fall in blood pressure will reflexly increase the heart rate, will cause reflex tachycardia, and in turn will increase oxygen demand. Also, there will be decrease in coronary perfusion that will also lead to rapid fall in blood pressure. More oxygen demand due to reflex sympathetic activation, and nifedipine can cause coronary still phenomenon. Because in IHD patients, the coronaries are already maximally dilated, nifedipine can dilate all arteries, including collaterals. So, nifedipine-induced arteriolar dilatation in non-ischemic zone will shunt oxygenated blood away from the ischemic zone. And this can cause coronary still and can precipitate angina. Then, which calcium channel blocker should be considered? Slower onset, longer acting calcium channel blocker, amlodipine, does not have this faster action, so do not cause this phenomenon. So can be thought as a drug of choice for continued maintenance treatment for patient having vasospastic angina. But their calcium channel blockers are contraindicated if there is tight aortic stenosis, severe myocardial depression, bradycardia and heart block, clinical heart failure, unstable angina, patient having pre-existing hypotension, along with digoxin, it may exacerbate AV block and heart failure, and non-DHPs with beta blockers may exacerbate heart block. Obviously, abrupt withdrawal of calcium channel blocker after long-term treatment may aggravate angina or can precipitate MI. Calcium channel blocker, we have got potassium channel openers. Potassium channel openers used in angina are nicorandil and pinacidil. If we look to the pharmacological basis, potassium channel openers are also NO donor, like nitrates. But the basis is they can open up ATP sensitive potassium channel in the myocardium, so they can cause enhanced potassium efflux. And there will be membrane hyperpolarization, and there will be decreased calcium entry that will reduce intracellular calcium availability, that will cause smooth relaxation, and with the nitric oxide donor, there will be more vasodilatation resulting into reduction in preload and afterload, and they will cause coronary dilatation as well. Potassium channel openers are particularly useful as alternative to nitrates or beta blockers in presence of asthma or heart failure. Friends, apart from these main groups, there are certain add-on therapies. Cytoprotective agents and antiplatelets can be considered as adjuvant therapy. Cytoprotective agents, trimetazidine, ranolazine. Trimetazidine is partial inhibitor of fatty acid oxidation. It is claimed that trimetazidine can improve myocardial glucose metabolism. It maintains AV function without altering hemodynamic effect. So it can be used as an add-on therapy in stable angina of effort. Ranolazine is slightly dangerous drug. The mechanism of action is it is selective inhibitor of late sodium influx and thus preventing calcium overload and inhibits fatty acid oxidation. But it can, the positive remark is it can increase exercise tolerance. But negative remark is there are more side effects like dizziness and nausea. Also, we have to be very watchful when we are treating our patient with ranolazine. It is contraindicated in hepatic impairment patients and patients having prolonged QT interval. Also, it has got number of interaction because it is metabolized by cytochrome P isoenzyme 3A4. So various drugs who are having an effect on cytochrome P isoenzyme 3A4 can alter the effect of ranolazine. Ivabradine is funny channel blocker. In the SA node, it selectively inhibits the SA nodal activity. It is considered as heart lowering agent. It is particularly added for patients having high resting heart rates. So ivabradine can be considered as, mind well, it is funny channel blocker. Antiplatelets have got prophylactic role. They prophylactically inhibit platelet activity and reduce incidence of MI in angina. Antiplatelets are added as preventive measures. Friends, after having the note about drugs useful in angina, let us see the stepwise approach of drug therapy. First of all, we have to control the risk factors. Obesity, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, alcohol or smoking, nicotine, these are all risk factors. So we have to take care of these risk factors first. Then treat the concomitant disease, anemia, hyperthyroidism, valvular heart disease, heart failure, etc. We have to treat the concomitant disease. We have to avoid the drugs having sympathomimetic amines like cold remedies, antihistaminics, anorectic agents, aminophylline, and antidepressants, etc. These drugs should be avoided. So these are the initial steps to be thought of. Then symptomatic management. At the acute onset of anginal pain, we can give nitrates either by sublingual route or by buccal spray. For mild to moderate symptoms, we can give long-term therapy with either beta blockers if not contraindicated or calcium channel blockers. If both the groups are contraindicated or not tolerated, then isosorbide dinitrate or mononitrate can be given along with nicorandil. If symptoms still persist, combination therapy with cytoprotective agents can be given. But if severe and not responding to medical management, then surgical revascularization in the form of percutaneous intervention and stenting or even CABG should be considered. Let us see the medical management of various angina pectoris. For first and foremost, for exertional angina, or we can say it angina of effort or stable angina. For acute prophylaxis, those known patients who are prone to get angina, they can take prophylactically nitroglycerin sublingually. The effect will last for 30 minutes. So sublingual nitroglycerin 5 mg should be taken 15 minutes prior to any stressful activity, walking uphill or going upwards, staircase, etc. In case of acute attack, either sublingual or buccal spray, sublingual tablet or buccal spray of nitroglycerin, it can be repeated after 5 minutes if pain has not subsided. For long-term prophylaxis, long-acting nitrates with beta blockers or calcium channel blockers can be given orally. And in case of severe and repeated symptoms, revascularization mode, coronary angioplasty with stenting can be considered. For the treatment of vasospastic angina, for acute attack, nitroglycerin sublingually can be given. And for prevention, tablet amlodipine 10 mg OD once orally. This is the treatment for the prevention of vasospastic angina or angina at rest. Then comes acute coronary syndrome. It is type of unstable angina. In unstable angina, there is incomplete vascular obstruction. There is no ischemia actually, but patient get repeated anginal pain. If it is not well maintained or managed, it can go to myocardial infarction. Acute MI can also be of two types. The early phase is non-ST segment MI. There is incomplete vascular obstruction, with marked thickening of vessel wall and small area of necrosis. Biochemical markers, not biological, biochemical markers are slightly raised. No ST elevation is seen in case of ECG. But ST segment elevation MI, that is complete vascular obstruction, full thickness ventricular wall and larger area of myocardium is necrosed. Biochemical markers prominently raised, and ST segment is elevated in case of ECG manifestation. These are the ECG pictures of NSTMI. The ST segment is still depressed, whereas in case of STMI, there is ST elevation. This is you can say it is because of the complete obstruction and necrosis. NSTMI can be managed with drugs. STMI should not be managed with drugs, have to go for percutaneous intervention. So in case of unstable angina, drug therapy is patient needs aggressive therapy in ICCU to prevent MI. In case of NSTMI can be managed by drugs, but in STMI immediately angiography should be done followed by either plasty or CABG. But drugs which are useful for NSTMI, antiplatelet drugs, tablet aspirin or clopidogrel, 75 to 300 mg. The justification is because of platelet aggregation, it can occlude narrowed coronaries and can release potent vasoconstrictors. So this phenomena is blocked by using antiplatelet agents. Sublingual nitroglycerin or IV intravenous isosorbide dinitrate that reduces cardiac workload and relieves pain. Subcutaneous or intravenous heparin that will also helpful to reduce pain. Other drugs apart from this pain management and immediate treatment, beta blockers, if not contraindicated, tablet atenolol can be given 50 to 100 mg. Calcium channel blocker, verapamil 30 to 60 mg 4 times a day, or diltiazem 30 to 60 mg 4 times a day. 3 times a day. GP2B 3A blockers, epsiximab, eptafibatide or tirofibam can be considered when the patient is admitted as antiplatelet agents. Acute myocardial infarction is ischemic necrosis of a portion of the myocardium due to occlusion of a branch of coronary artery. When there is prolonged myocardial ischemia, precipitated in most cases by an occlusive coronary thrombus or less commonly due to prolonged coronary spasm, this can lead to myocardial infarction. It's a medical emergency which requires immediate attention and hospitalization. Clinical features are same like angina with profuse sweating and hypotension. Diagnosis can be confirmed by ECG and biochemical markers. There will be rise in CPK-MB and troponin I. These are the enzymes which are released from the necrosed part of myocardium. So in case these markers are raised, that means there is a portion of necrosed myocardium and it's a case of myocardial infarction. We see how coronary thrombus and prolonged MI causes pain in the, trouble in the life. Whenever there is coronary thrombus, it can lead to prolonged myocardial ischemia. This prolonged myocardial ischemia will release some metabolic products like lactic acids or any other vasodilator peptides as a, you can say, corrective phenomenon. But these peptides, lactic acids, metabolic products, they are 5-HT and all, they will have severe pain. And because of the pain, there will be anxiety. With the anxiety and pain, there will be more sympathetic activity that will lead to ventricular fibrillation. And in a nutshell, there will be more cardiac work and less cardiac efficiency. Prolonged myocardial ischemia will lead to necrosis and apoptosis that will also cause ventricular fibrillation and will have decreased cardiac efficiency. And very prolonged necrosis will lead to myocardial cell death. This is the physiology of myocardial infarction. Now let us drug targets, which drugs can be helpful at various levels. Coronary thrombus, if goes for prolonged myocardial infarction or myocardial ischemia, can be blocked by antiplatelets and nitrates as a preventive measures. And after there is attack of myocardial infarctions, thrombolytics can dissolve that plaque. Pain produced by the metabolic products can be blocked by opioids, and benzodiazepine can allay anxiety. We know that there is, because of pain and anxiety, there is increased sympathetic activity that can be blocked by beta blockers, and beta blockers can also help to inhibit ventricular fibrillation. On top of it, lignocaine as antiarrhythmic drug also will be helpful to inhibit ventricular fibrillation. And after the hemodynamic effect has been stabilized, AC inhibitors will be helpful to prevent cardiac, to stabilize cardiac efficiency. So these are the drugs which can be helpful at various levels. The goal of therapy when the patient is diagnosed to have myocardial infarction should be first and foremost relief of pain and anxiety, then prevention of thrombus extension. After that, establish the reperfusion. Once the perfusion has been re-established, prevention of immediate complication, and later on prevention of long-term complications including reinfarction. So this should be our aim of therapy or goal of therapy. How can we treat a patient who is diagnosed to have myocardial infarction? Medical management of acute MI before hospitalization or at a primary level, primary care, what you can give once you have diagnosed the patient to have myocardial infarction. For relief of pain and anxiety, give immediately nitroglycerin sublingually 0.4 mg every 5 minutes till pain is relieved. You can give maximum up to 3 doses. Meanwhile, you have to shift the patient to higher center or at least ICU. In ICU or in casualty, manage the patient by giving IV morphine 10 mg over 10 minutes. Alternatively, you can give buprenorphine 0.4 mg subcutaneously or IM or even sublingually. Diazepam can also be given to allay anxiety to cool down the patient. If patient is having profuse vomiting, then antiemetics can be given in the IV line. If it is given in IV line, we can consider about ondansetron or PPI. Ondansetron with PPIs. If patient can tolerate oral, then we can give metoclopramide or even we can give fenhydramine 25 mg. Chew tab of aspirin or clopidogrel. Ask the patient to crush the tablet of aspirin or clopidogrel and chew it to prevent further thrombus extension. This should be our primary treatment. When the patient is shifted to ICU, when the patient is shifted to ICU, proper rest and maintain oxygen. Establish reperfusion and prevent extension of thrombus within 6 to 12 hours. This can be considered as golden time. IV streptokinase 1.5 million units over 1 hour, or if patient can afford, urokinase, altiplase or tenecteplase can be given. They are the thrombolytics. They can dissolve the thrombus plug. Plus tablet aspirin or clopidogrel should be continued 75 to 150 mg once a day. When the patient is in the bedridden state, to prevent deep vein thrombosis, heparin can be given initially by IV route followed by subcutaneous route. Drug therapy to prevent immediate complications, vasodilators, nitroglycerin or sodium nitroprusside by IV infusion. Beta blockers, if not contraindicated, can be given. IV atenolol 5 to 10 mg over 5 minutes. Later on, can be shifted to metoprolol 5 mg over 2 minutes. And then can be considered switch to oral therapy. When stable hemodynamics is achieved, AC inhibitors can be given, tablet lisinopril or ramipril, within 6 hours and continue further. Inotropic agents, IV dobutamine or dopamine to support cardiac function if cardiac function is damaged. Prevention and treatment of arrhythmia, IV injection lignocaine 1 to 2 mg per minute IV can be given. And general measures like benzodiazepine for sedation and anxiety, liquid or semi-solid diet. If patient is hypertensive, then salt restricted diet, or patient is diabetic, then diabetic diet, and stool softeners to prevent constipation. Once we have managed our patient well, the patient's heart is again functioning well. At the time of discharge, what we have to advise? Rehabilitation, graded increase in physical activity and exercise therapy. Advise the patient to avoid cardiac risk factors like smoking, alcohol, or any other addictive substances. If patient is smoking, having a history of smoking, then nicotine substitution may be advised. At the time of discharge, we have to advise drug therapy to prevent long-term complications and reoccurrence of any cardiac events. Aspirin or clopidogrel, 75 to 15, 150 mg OD. Lisinopril or ramipril can be given once a day. Tablet atenolol or metoprolol can be given once a day. If patient is having hypercholesterolemia, hyperlipidemia, then hypolipidemic agents, statins, atorvastatin or any other similar statin can be given at night. Drug therapy for associated diseases like continued drug therapy for hypertension, diabetes or any other precipitating factors. And lifestyle modification by taking care of obesity, yoga and meditation. Ask the patient to be in touch and come for regular checkups. So that was about ischemic cardiac diseases or ischemic heart disease. Apart from them, we will be considering about other peripheral vascular disorders. They can be of two types, obstructive or vasospastic. Obstructive disorders, because of atherosclerosis or thromboanginitis obliterans with large vessels, other vessels apart from coronaries. Or in case of diabetes, there will be atherosclerosis of smaller vessels like retinal or renal arteries. So the treatment modalities can be correction of underlying factors, CHF, anemia or diabetes mellitus, lifestyle modification, cessation of smoking, physical exercises, walking, cycling, swimming, foot care, cleanliness and avoidance of any injury or infection. Drug therapy can be low dose aspirin or clopidogrel, statins to lower cholesterol level. Pentoxifilline, it is considered as hemorrhagic drug that helps blood to flow through narrowed arteries. So pentoxifilline 400 mg twice a day can be given, but when we are putting our patient on pentoxifilline, we have to advise them to be aware about bleeding tendencies. Tablet cilostazol 100 mg twice a day, 30 minutes before and 2 hours after meal. Tablet naftidofuril oxalate, that is 5-3 antagonist. So serotonin induced vasoconstriction can be inhibited. So this is about obstructive peripheral vascular disease. Then vasospastic, that is known as Raynaud's phenomenon or Raynaud syndrome. The chief complaint of patient is patient will have bluish discoloration of extremities, especially fingers and toenails when they are exposed to extreme cold. So that this is a type of vascular disorder characterized by a pale or blue to red sequence of color changes in the digits, more commonly after exposure to cold. Raynaud's phenomenon occurs because of the spasm of smaller blood vessels. The treatment modalities are 5 treatments for Raynaud's disease or Raynaud phenomenon. These are non-pharmacological because these are seen in smokers. So we have to ask the patient to stop smoking, avoid caffeine, avoid medicaments that cause tightening of blood vessels or vasoconstrictors, keep the body warm, Avoid exposure to cold, wearing mittens or gloves outdoors or when handling with cold items. Wear comfortable roomy shoes and woolen socks. So these are some non-pharmacological modalities. And pharmacological therapy, calcium channel blocker, nifedipine is helpful over here. Nifedipine 5 to 10 milligram 3 times a day, or we can also give diltiazem. Beta adrenergic stimulants like isoxazoline or nalindrene can be given. Alpha blockers like prazosin or tolazosin can be given. If we are giving prazosin, that we have to start with a lesser dose at night. Gradually we can increase up to 1 to 2 milligram twice a day to avoid first dose effect, that is orthostatic hypotension. Anticoagulants, heparin subcutaneously or warfarin orally can be given. Vasodilators like nitroglycerin patch or any other vasodilators can be thought about. So that was all about peripheral vascular disorders also. This can be asked sometimes in Viva. But angina or MI can be asked as a long question.